Welcome back to Pop Dissected. Today, we're going to be talking about the rise of singer, songwriter, and rapper Qveen Herby. If you're not familiar with Qveen Herby, she used to be part of the pop duo Karmin, who had a run from about 2010 until about 2017. Before we dive into Qveen Herby's rising, we're going to have to turn back the clock and take a look at her beginnings. Qveen Herby's name is Amy Noonan, née Hydeman. She attended the Berklee College of Music, where she met her current husband, Nick Noonan. They both graduated from the university in 2008. The couple grew in popularity from their covers of various songs on YouTube, under the account Karmin Covers, their most notable being their cover of Chris Brown's Look at Me Now. This cover is really what projected the duo into the spotlight. This was also a time where a lot of artists were being discovered and recognized on YouTube. The idea of YouTube covers was actually a breakthrough for Amy. She stated she grew up in a Christian household in Nebraska, and wasn't allowed to listen to anything with a parental advisory label on it. She would rap in the shower, but always had a fear about posting it online. And she thanks her husband Nick for pushing her to cross that boundary. What made Amy stand out at the time was her vintage style, being described as a 40s film star in a black corset and ruby red lipstick. Her vintage style, paired with her ability to spit out rhymes like lightning, really made her unique, as one wouldn't necessarily expect someone with a retro style to be oriented in rap music. With their popularity booming, the duo got to perform with The Roots at Tufts University, appear on The Ellen DeGeneres Show, and on air with Ryan Seacrest. They also won the first ever New Media Award at the American Music Awards. This exposure led to the duo being signed to Epic Records in 2011, and Karmin was officially catapulted into the mainstream. Some may be wondering, what exactly does Karmin mean? It's a homophone, combining Karmin, the Latin word for song, and the word karma. Did someone say genius? I think so. Their first single was released on October 20th, 2011, entitled Crash Your Party. They stated they felt it was the perfect first single, as they were crashing the party of the music industry, and in a way, directing the spotlight onto them. The single peaked at number 36 on the Billboard US Mainstream Top 40 chart. Karmin's first big performance was on Saturday Night Live on February 11th, 2012, in which they performed two original songs, Broken Hearted and I Told You So. Broken Hearted was released as the first single off their upcoming debut EP, just 4 days before this performance. It's a song about not wanting a potential love interest to stand you up and to try and show their commitment. For a song with a quote-unquote sad title, it's a very upbeat, fun, and positive song. The track received positive reviews from critics, and was seen as a leap in their career that would launch them into superstardom. The track peaked at number 1 on Billboard's US Dance Club Songs, and number 16 on the Billboard Hot 100. On May 4th of that year, their debut EP, Hello, was released. Amy stated the title was the perfect introduction to the duo, and the track listing of the songs actually tells the story of Karmin. In the cover, we both see Amy and Nick sporting pretty retro-inspired outfits, further continuing their established image. Unfortunately, the EP was met with lukewarm reception, to say the least, some critics citing the music as aggressive and daft. In my opinion, I think this is a great EP. Amy's vocals when she's rapping really showcase a unique voice style, such as her intonation, pitch, and dialect. It's interesting. I think many critics may not have liked how Amy chose to vocalize, but nonetheless, it made her and her husband Nick stand out. None of the 7 tracks really sound similar. They're all unique in their own story, sound, and lyricism. Nick even sings the lead vocals in the track Coming Up Strong. The final single off the EP was the title track, released July 31st of 2012. It also peaked at number 1 on Billboard's US Dance Club Songs, and 62 on the Billboard Hot 100. In August of that year, Karmin announced that they were working on a full-length record, which would be released that November. However, the album saw many delays. The first single off their debut record, A Cappella, was released July 9th of 2013. The track found inspiration from the film Pitch Perfect, which follows an a cappella singing group. In the track, Amy raps and sings about a lover who isn't the one for her, and she's going at life solo. The track received mixed to positive reviews from critics, peaking at number 34 on Billboard's US Mainstream Top 40 charts, and 72 on the Hot 100. The video is explained as truly showing Karmin's style, paying homage to 90s videos and featuring the duo on different sets themed around one specific color. Their debut record was now slated for a December 31st release, but never arrived as it was denied by Karmin's manager. There's speculation that there were issues between Karmin and Epic Records. Allegedly, picking a second single was a battle, and the label demanded the duo to produce more pop-oriented tracks, which is not exactly the direction they wanted to go in. Amy at this point is known for her rapping, so it makes sense the duo would want to focus predominantly on rap-oriented songs. In my opinion, if all this speculation is in fact true, Epic may have wanted Karmin to pursue a pop direction with their debut, as Broken Hearted, a mainly pop track, was their most successful effort off of Hello. I Want It All released as their second single on January 28th, 2014. At this time, their debut record was still not released. I Want It All peaked at 39 on the US mainstream top 40, and failed to chart on the Hot 100. What's interesting is this track lacks Amy's signature rapping. I think this single was chosen by the label to push Karmin in a pop direction, which in turn strayed from what they really wanted to do. The track was criticized for lacking Amy's rapping, yet their EP Hello was criticized for Amy's rapping. It's a weird juxtaposition that really makes no sense. After 2 years of development and rescheduling, their debut record, Pulses, released on March 25th, 2014. The title was given to reflect the highs and lows in life, and Amy stated that she and Nick felt more like a duo on this record. Pulses peaked at 32 on the Hot 100 and received mixed reviews. The most common consensus I could find about the record was that it felt formulaic and just abided to pop conventions without doing anything outside of the box. Amy has stated she loves doing things differently and going against the grain, and I think Pulses in a way was really led by Epic Records, and they in turn caused the record to not perform well. In September of 2014, they split with Epic Records, Amy citing that her and Nick wanted to make more authentic music. I think this may further prove Epic had a hand in dictating Pulses, from the single choices to the sound. Their second record, Leo Rising, fits into a much more alternative genre, still containing elements of pop, but also featuring a lot of Amy's amazing rapping. The record is built around the 12 astrological signs, with each track representing one of the signs. The record was almost 100% produced and written by Amy and Nick, so this time they were able to have entire creative freedom. Though Amy said that she wanted to be more authentic with this record, she stated she's still thankful for their start, and they wouldn't have the opportunities they have without their preceding projects. Leo Rising released September 9th, 2016, and peaked at 27 on Billboard's Independent Albums chart. Five singles were released from the record. The first, Sugar, being released October 1st of 2014. The following singles, Along the Road, Didn't Know You, Come With Me, Pure Imagination, and Blame It on My Heart, were released throughout 2015 and 2016, until the record's eventual release. In the beginning of 2017, Amy stated new music was in the works. Later that year, Karmin was rebranded as Qveen Herby. Amy stated when her and Nick began making new music, it couldn't be under Karmin. Naturally, things evolved and Qveen Herby was born. Qveen was a nickname given to Amy in college, and Herby was the mascot of the Nebraska Cornhuskers, which actually means warrior. Qveen's first single was Busta Rhymes, which she said was inspired by Busta Rhymes himself, one of her favorite rappers. She believes that there should be a girl doing what Busta does, speed rapping. Qveen has stated that her ultimate endgame is to inspire people to feel like bosses, to feel empowered, specifically women. When listening to her music, there's a very cohesive theme of self-empowerment, even if it isn't in the most conventional way, most people would deliver it. But as we know, Amy does not follow convention. Throughout her and Nick's career, they've always done their best to be different and stand out, following their own path. Qveen has said when she writes music, she wants honest and raw emotion, and when something she's writing about scares her, she knows it's good. And I think that's true. When working creatively, if there's territory that makes you scared or anxious, that's the direction you should go in, because that's where you'll make leaps and bounds. Qveen Herby is signed to the label Checkbook. Since 2017, she's released 7 EPs, all named after their chronology, EP1, EP2, EP3, and so on. EP1 peaked at number 37 on the US Independent Albums charts, and number 13 on the US Heatseekers album charts. All tracks from Qveen's EPs are produced by Nick, with additional production from other collaborators. Qveen has featured several artists on some of her other tracks, such as Monogem, Malibu Mitch, Sonia Elise, Farrah Fox, Blimes, and Gifted Gab. EP 2 featured three singles, Love Myself, Wifey, and Holiday. EP 3 saw That Bih, Sade in the 90s, and All These Hoes as singles. Alone, BDE, Mozart, and Cheap Talk were all released as singles off EP 4, 5, 6, and 7 respectively. In between EP 6 and EP 7, Qveen released a smaller EP entitled The Vignettes, featuring three shorter songs, all released as singles. Nick Noonan has been credited as a director for six of her music videos, with Benjamin Farron credited with five. Qveen has stated that she loves releasing EPs so frequently because it's like releasing half an album every few months. In turn, she's been able to really perfect herself as an artist and hone in on her artistic vision. She stated she hopes to tour soon and not only connect with her fans that joined her as Qveen Herby, but with the ones who have been with her since she was Karmin. Amy is really doing things her own way, and it shows. It's amazing she's able to have what seems to be full control over her career, from sound, style, videos, releases, and so on. As of now, Qveen Herby has released 38 tracks across all her EPs, and four additional remixes that served as promotional singles. With such an expansive catalog, it's going to be quite interesting to see what songs she'll perform on the tour. My guess is she'd most likely stick to the 18 tracks she's released as singles that also all have music videos. But we know Amy, and she'll do it however she wants. I'm hoping to see my personal favorites, Zombie, Holiday, Sade in the 90s, Nintendo, BDE, New Bitch, and Cheap Talk. So what's next for Qveen Herby? She's clearly interested in touring, and even discussed potentially signing to a major label, which in turn would give her a bigger platform. But with that, we may have the issues that allegedly went on during the Pulses era. But Amy's a strong woman, and she has an amazing team. I know they'll be able to hold their ground if there's any creative friction between her team and a label. I personally would love to see Qveen Herby go on a tour, and then maybe release a full-length record. As of now, she's been setting the scene and introducing herself to the world as a brand new artist, so she's taking her time. Before we close off this video, I want to discuss the criticism Qveen Herby has faced as a white woman who raps. It's important to know, Amy has always rapped, and she's always loved that genre. She's inspired by many great rappers and looks up to them. After Karmin, she didn't randomly decide that she was going to be a rapper. I think Amy is really giving a new dimension to the genre, and if she's caused any issues, I know that none of them were intentional. Her mission as an artist is to inspire and empower others, not to cause harm or be problematic. At the end of it all, the journey Amy and Nick have gone through has been wild. They've had quite the experience, through any highs and lows they may have faced. Right now, I believe they're both in a place where they're living their absolute best life and making music that is truly their vision and their story. At the end of the day, that's what making art is about, being authentic, being vulnerable, and even inspiring people. Long live the Qveen. Thank you so much for watching, everyone. Comment down below what your favorite EP is by Qveen Herby. Be sure to like and subscribe for more future content on all your favorite pop stars.